Hey everybody, this is Rob from What Are You Watching? The show where we talk about what are you watching. Today our guest is Garrett Swann, the true Renaissance man. Garrett has done everything from acting to producing to art directing. He's a model. He has a clothing line. He's got an Instagram TV show that we're going to talk about. He's a social media influencer. And now he's even starting a new business that we want to learn a lot about as well. So Garrett, welcome to the show.
Thanks, buddy. Thank you. This is great. So it's funny. It's like, I feel like I'm constant. When you name off all those things, it's pretty much the progression of my life, reinventing myself. It's constantly trying to find ways of doing something different and interesting and kind of, and survive at the same time, because I've had my bouts with being being an actor, and I was an art director one time, and then I acted in between all of that, and then I got this hit small, like 14.5 minutes of fame. I didn't quite get 15. And so then it just kind of progressed and things morphed and changed. And I'm like, I want to do this. I want to do that. And I've been able to survive and get by. And now I'm like, okay, now I need to make the serious money.
Oh, now. But like, yeah. I'm curious. So you grew up in California, right?
Yeah, Santa Barbara.
So you're sort of in the world of entertainment, right? And you know, and all that. How do you come up? You know, did you go to school out there as well?
Well, I was born and raised in Santa Barbara, and you know, we were really a TV culture, because you know that's what we did. You know, I mean, listen, I'm totally ADD, but when you have me in front of a television and you try to say something to me, I will not even listen. Like, I won't even know what else is going on. Like, I have full-on tunnel vision.
Yeah.
So I've grown up with that generation. And, you know, my parents were older, too. So I got to understand a lot of their old movie culture, of things that they loved. Like, you know, films from, you know, the 1940s and the 50s. And then there was AMC. And so... And right. And because I was in theater, it was really discovering all those films, like discovering one of my favorite films is Breakfast at Tiffany's, you know, and a lot of those historical films, like back in the early 50s, of like Rebel Without a Cause and A Place in the Sun with Montgomery Clift. So yeah. Like I learned a lot about a lot of those movies too were very historic in the way, you know, like there's one of my other favorite films is called All About Eve with Betty Davis.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's about even women's culture and those sorts of things. So I didn't realize how I was so into it. But now as an adult, I kind of go, oh, I know why I got it like that. And now I can analyze it a little bit more and appreciate the art of filmmaking and TV way more than I did.
Well, and those are really, you know, you're talking about classics right there as well.
Of course.
And like back then, so when you're watching those as movies, were there certain TV shows you even remember from that period, or was it all movies?
Well, you know, I mean, I Love Lucy was one of the classic comedies. I mean, it really set the course of comedy television.
For sure.
For everybody. That and The Honeymooners, but more so for me, I think I watched every episode of I Love Lucy. And, you know, and The Brady Bunch was another show, you know? Yeah. I mean, that was really my generation. I'm trying to think of what I watched in the 1980s, television was just kind of, it became
well, you had
a little
like the up and comers, like a Different Strokes, you know,
yeah. Right, give me a right, break, absolutely, you know, right. Yes.
Remember that?
One of the best shows, one show that I did love, and it was very, it was called Good Times.
Sure.
And that show was amazing. What was his name?
The
father.
The dynamite or the dad?
Well, no, that was Jimmy Walker, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but who was the father?
Oh, he was in Roots, that the dad.
Yes. I can't remember his name.
But we're going to dump really that name in. It's going to come right on the screen right now.
Right, it was a family. I think they were in the projects. Were they in Chicago, I believe?
You know,
was it Chicago?
It might have been Chicago. For some reason, like as a New Yorker, I always thought it was New York, but you might be right. Yeah.
I mean, I grew up with the Jeffersons. So I grew up with these, right. You know, like the fact that I live on the Upper East Side, all I can think of is that song, I'm moving on up to the East Side to a deluxe apartment in the sky.
How many dry cleaners do you own?
Right. Well, you know what's wonderful about even those shows back then? It's the jingles of the television series. You remember those, like Three's Company, like that show. It's like, come and knock on our door.
Yes, of course.
We've been waiting for you.
Sing them all.
Come and knock on our door.
Come and knock on our door.
We've been waiting for you.
We've been waiting for you.
Where the kisses are hers and hers and his. Three's Company too.
You know, yeah. I recently did a review on Family Ties. You know, I love Family Ties. Yeah, you know?
I worked with Alan Thicke.
You did? No, well, Alan Thicke was Growing Pains.
Oh, he was Growing Pains.
Family Ties was the Michael J. Fox, you know.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's
so
right,
you
that's
worked
right,
with Alan Thicke. What was that on?
I was on a reality series that he and his wife, a third wife, did, Tanya Thicke, and their son, Carter Thicke. And I was in about maybe three episodes. It was called Unusually Thick. It was produced originally for Canadian television, and it was shot in Santa Barbara because he lived in Santa Barbara. Uh-huh. But I had a one degree of separation from them because my nephews used to play hockey with Carter Thick. Uh-huh. And so I got cast as a buddy of Tanya's in that series. And I ended up being in two both seasons. I was supposed to be a series regular for the second season because the executive producer really loved me as Tanya's buddy. But then things got, and then I shot a day with Alan, and it was just like, it was really weird. He was directing me, and the director was directing me, and the writer was directing me. And I was like, I can't, like, this is just too much.
Well, Growing Pains was an all-timer for me.
But, oh, yeah.
You know, it's funny you talk about the opening songs. Because like I was saying to you before, your opening of your undercover show cracks me up because it's like a throwback to that. I don't know if that was the intent. You're like, you know,
no, but that's really like, a good observation. You know. Yeah.
It's very funny.
I like even the music, the background music, I wanted this kind of like 1970s loungy French music in the background, like some like hip, cool, like early 70s. Like I wanted this kind of chill vibe that was kind of Frenchy, you know, cause I'm a little bit of a Francophile. So I found like the right tune, and like I paid a lot of money for the licensing of that, but I'm going to use that for the next seasons coming up.
So it's interesting. Are you filming? Do you have someone? Well, pre-corona, did you have someone filming it, or did you just prop a camera? Like,
oh, I just propped my iPhone and just shot it. What, like one shot?
Okay, because
it framed it out.
And then I was watching, I was watching some of the quarantine ones, and you did some good film work there because you had a camera filming you, right? But there. Did you have the guests film themselves too or something?
Yes. So I asked them, I gave them a brief of how to position the camera on their phone. So when you spliced it, we spliced together. So it was look like we're looking at each other, but we're really in the same bed, but we're not.
Yeah. I thought that was a good touch. Cause I was actually trying to kind of figure out what it was you were doing there to make that work. So that went well. Yeah.
That's cool. Thanks. It was fun.
Yeah, but when you interviewed,
But it's not the same as being with the person. There's a spark that kind of. It's hard doing it with COVID in mind that we can't be around other people and that we have to do these interviews via FaceTime or Zoom or whatever. That there's not that immediate. Like connection in person, there's a difference.
Oh, for sure. I mean that goes, you know, a long way. But you know, when you have a show called Undercovers where you're interviewing people in bed, you know, quarantine and Corona could not have been worse, right?
Right. Totally.
Yeah. No, I think everybody's being affected by the not being able to kind of interact with people the way they really want to. it's so tough, you know.
And, yeah.
You know, and I don't even know.
It's annoying. I'm annoyed. I want to hug people. I want to hug people and like grab them and kiss them on the cheek and, you know, like, and have that interaction. Cause I love that physical contact with people.
Yeah.
You know, I get to do that with my husband, but you know, it's like, I mean, a few friends, we've been like, are you hugging? Are you not hugging? You
want right.
to hug? No.
You know, you're giving the elbow, you know.
Yeah, elbow.
I mean, it's what it's come to. And yeah, I mean, even, you know, when I was, you know, I had to give my mom a hug and it was like, you know, it was weird, you know, which it shouldn't be, you know.
Yeah.
But, all right. So we touched on undercovers. I mean, I could talk about that forever. I do have a question for you and then we can move on.
Yeah.
Watching your first episodes as someone who's getting going in this, do you see a change or, you know, from when you first started doing it to, you know, how you're thinking about things now and adjustments you've made or you know, how you thought the show might have been and what it became?
I think now it's always, as everything, it's like practice makes perfect. The more you do it, the better it gets. And you know, I think I had been off of camera for a while, and I think there was just becoming a comfortability with, I think it had a lot to do with my guests too, of how comfortable I am and what I'm trying to, and remembering questions. Like at first I had, you know, I had cue cards in my hand, and I finally was like, you know what? I need to just remember these questions and could just continue the conversation.
Right.
But you know, I at the end of the day, it's really about being present, which sometimes I'm not very good at. And so I think once I start learning that, and again, if I have a rapport, like with Tracy Lee Ross, it was, I felt a little bit of a connection with her. So I think it was a little bit easier to have that conversation without needing to feel rehearsed or, you know, I just felt it was at ease and everyone gave me great feedback from it. So that was nice.
Well, you have this like and I'm just meeting you, you know, we've talked a few times and we're mutual friends, but you have like this sort of carefree, happy, infectious kind of vibe to you that I honestly thought every single person you interviewed that I watched were your friends. Yeah.
Yeah. You know? Well, a lot of them were, but some people like Lucy Spraggan, I had just met like the night before briefly. And I know, cause I went to go see her perform and I just met her briefly and she was so lovely. And then once we had the interview, we ended up becoming great friends.
Well, you had, I don't know if this is that woman, but you interviewed a woman who was, you know, high up, you know, fashion director or something. And you asked her, you said, so what's your new favorite? You know, what's coming? And she said that Canvas or talking.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
and
yeah,
then,
yeah.
And then your next interview or soon after you interviewed that guy.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I met, oh my God, Alex Dickerson back in December at an event. And it was one of those love at first sight kind of meetings. She's like, she's like, when the fuck are we going to brunch? Like, that was the first thing she said to me. And I was like, yeah, and I love her. And I just love her energy. And she's so funny and so clever. And so, and then she talked about Christian Jewel Nielsen, who's the designer for Auchinvoss. And then he's also the creative director for Hervé Léger. And so I was like, oh my God, I want to, and he responded to the video and I was like, oh my God. And then I was like, hey, I want to interview you sometime. And he goes, I would love that. And so, and I had never met him until I did that video with him.
Mm-hmm. So now you're doing this show. You've done so many other things in entertainment and modeling and now all of a sudden social media, not all of a sudden at this point, but social media is exploding. You know, you've got this huge following on Instagram, you're Facebook, and you can now launch your own show. thinking back, like, what do you think about this whole influencer marketing, you know, thing?
Well, I mean, a lot at the end of the day, sometimes I feel like it's a little bit of a popularity contest, because here I am 51 trying to gain followers, you know, and I mean, I was doing the sexy daddy thing, but then, you know, the more I realized that I could utilize that for brand partnerships, because, and work those brands into my authentic everyday life, and working with brands that I authentically like what they're doing. Like, I just did something with Ritual Vitamins, and they're great. Like, is a, you know, when you get a open a bottle of vitamins, they smell like clinical, or not clinical, but they sound like really herbal. These smell like mint. You know, it's like, I want, it's like, it makes you want to take the vitamin. So anyways, I think influencer marketing has become a big, huge deal, because I think that brands come to us because they want to see their product in real life situations with that person. Yeah. So, and I get that. And I think that's, and I think there's an authenticity to that, but there's a lot of guys that are very posy, and I'm totally going to admit that there are times where I'm very posy, and I've been trying to veer away from that and just be more present in even the photographs and so on and so forth. Because when you get your picture taken, you're posing for a picture, you know, technically. So it's really a fine line of trying to find some sort of authentic story and be a storyteller, and tell why, you know, and I get people like, you know, haggering me and saying mean things. It's like, whatever. At the end of the day, like, I sticks and stones. And I just want to put a good positive energy, because I have I've been through a lot of adversities in my life. And so surprisingly I'm able to take my experience and share it with others and make it their experience, that I can give them some information that I may have gotten through my journey that I can pass on to them, and they either choose to take it or leave it, you know? So I think it's really important to put out positive energy up there and talk about things that I do and how to have a long, healthy life. But there's not a lot of guys like me out there my age doing what I'm doing. There's probably a handful.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny, you know, when you say that, one of the things that I had in my notes about you was I wrote the word fearless. And that shines through in a big way, just looking at your Instagram, you know. So I think that's probably resonating with a lot of people. You won't see me running around in a bathing suit.
All those guys who are mean to me and defend me wrong.
It'd be my pleasure, honestly. Yeah, because you know what? I don't think any of those guys would run around in that skimpy little bathing suit like you do. Plus, you're ripped, you know. So you're in great shape.
Thanks.
I think you definitely are presenting a person who's happy, who's enjoying life, and who's willing to do anything. So
yeah.
I think that's certainly shining through. And like, I just met you, you know, so.
Yeah. Thanks,
I'm sure your friends think that, you know, many times over.
Takes one to know one.
You got it. So, all right. So, you know, I think we got to have a little fun here, right? This is a show about what are you watching? So.
What are you watching?
We talked about what you used to watch. But, you know, I'd love to hear, you know, Garrett Swann, what are you watching?
What am I watching? Well, I'm anything that's on Netflix and Hulu and Amazon, I've pretty much have binged everything possible. Recently, I've binged
4 months, right?
Yeah, I think I've seen everything. I just saw Little Fires Everywhere on Hulu with Reese Witherspoon and Kerry Washington. That was great.
On one of your interviews, you were talking about The Handmaid's Tale.
Obsessed. And yeah. Why? I mean, they were set to shoot in March, and they had to cancel shooting until.
No. I didn't know that.
So everything that was slated to shoot in the late winter, late winter and early spring was all postponed.
Well, I watched, do you watch Billions at all on Showtime?
I don't watch Billions.
So Billions, they had a great storyline going, and it just stopped. You were wondering, but they couldn't stop filming. But Handmaid's Tale, let's just talk about that for a second.
Okay, you know, I love that show.
She's an Elizabeth Moss is unbelievable, but to think about a world where that is going on, you know, where
this dystopia, it's this dystopian empire it's scary to think that really can happen.
Yeah,
guys, this is insane.
Get back in line.
Off plan?
No, I'm not gonna do it. I'm not gonna kill Janine, okay? No! Are you okay?
Girls! That is enough! You are to do your duty!
And kind of feels like it is kind of happening a little bit.
I know what you mean. When I was watching it, I was thinking, you know, this is crazy, but it's not like science fiction crazy. It could happen. And it's just unbelievable to me that these women are just powerless. Like they are treated as just baby making machines or, you know, caregivers. You know what I mean?
But are they powerless? I think that's what's wonderful about what these characters are discovering, that they're not. They're discovering that their strength and their power, their minds are just as, if not more, stronger than the men are. Men could be physically stronger, but the women mentally are stronger, so they're able to overcome those situations. And they fight back, like Elizabeth Moss, every episode, she's fighting back. And it was written by Margaret Atwood, am I correct?
That I will find out.
I think it's
because it is based on a book, right?
Yeah. Margaret Atwood. She's actually Canadian. So funny as it is. And I think her character is, I just love seeing that fight in her every time. And to me, I identify with that because it's whenever I'm overcoming an obstacle in life, those little small moments. I mean, she's on the verge of life versus death, you know, at all times, because she could be hung very easily in any circumstance. So she's treading, you know, she's walking on broken glass constantly, you know.
Remember that crazy place where it was like a garbage dump or whatever the heck that was, where, you know, where they were like, everybody's face was black and the women were full on slaves. Do you remember that whole scene with that?
Yes.
Woman?
Yes.
But that was so crazy. I don't know. That show is like, I enjoyed it so much and I can't wait to see more, but I was cringing a lot, definitely in the first season, until you get used to it.
You're right. And what they do, their score, their music score, and the way that they filter, their filterings on their coloring on the film, it really creates this kind of eeriness that it's really well done, and it's very cold, and it's very, you know, there's not a lot of warmth to it, but there's a coldness to it, and it's really like, and that bright, that kind of red that pops all the time, you know, it's, and red is, you know, what's red, the color is like blood, you know?
Right. It's intense. I love that one. And it's funny. It took a while for Hulu shows to be seen. And in a lot of ways, Handmaid's Tale is the reason, you know, that got more notoriety for Hulu for original programming.
Yeah. Of course.
So is there anything you're planning on watching right now, or it's up in the air?
I've finished recently too, about a month ago, was Ozark, which was incredible. I mean, Jason Bateman and Laura Linney are unbelievable. It like really, obsessed.
I know.
Did you watch the last episode?
What?
Did you watch the last episode?
Oh yeah. But we're a spoiler-free show, just to be clear.
Okay, we can't give away. Oh. Yeah.
We are positive reviews only and spoiler-free. That's our niche.
No, I won't bag on anything.
What did the idea for What Are You Watching is really that I'm telling you what you should watch, or we're talking about something we both watch. But okay, well, that was great.
Apparently, I have to watch girl on that.
What's that?
What was that?
The blonde girl on Ozark, who I've now realized has been in other stuff. She's really great too.
The daughter?
No, the
Who played Ruth?
Yes, she's great. Yeah.
Yes, fantastic as well. Yeah. I mean, that show was just very well cast, period.
You owe me a job.
What?
Am I speaking Greek?
Nice. Like a serial killer's lair.
All right, listen, motherfuckers. If you deviate from the plan, I'll take a dull fucking blade and cut y'all.
Well, listen, this is great. I feel like, now I know why, you know, you're so close with Marnie.
Forever. Wait, what about them doing their Christmas card dressing as Handmaid's Tale? That was brilliant.
Oh, I didn't see. I'm not on the list.
Yeah.
But I'd like to see that, so send me a picture of that.
I'll have to find that somewhere. I kept that because it was amazing.
So. Well, I know we didn't get a chance to talk about your new business, but we could talk about that another time
you and I can talk about that apart from this. Well, I'm developing a men's apparel brand called Alphex. My partner was the former CEO and president of a brand called To Exist, and he was let go about a year or so ago. He called me 3 days later and said, I have this idea, you and I should do a brand together. I said, that's really funny because I had the same idea yesterday. So we hope to launch spring of next year, because there's a lot that needs to be done before you launch a brand. But there's a lot of good stuff with that, because it's really kind of this holistic view of what it means to be a modern man in the 21st century, that we want guys to fit better, feel better, and be better.
Amen.
Be Alphex.
Well, that will be Alphex. And that will be our next interview. We're going to go all in on that. And then we'll hear what you're watching next.
Yes.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Garrett. It's great to meet you.
Bob, thank you. Hey, everyone. I'm Garrett Swann. And what I'd really like to know is, what are you watching?